Jack, those cables.
Okay, mics are going live.
CHAM AM Hamilton, a division of Bell Media. Your second favorite iHeart radio station. Funny 820.
This is the voyage of the starship, the Cadillac Bill Show, as we discover Hamilton, the final frontier.
Chicken. We've all eaten Kentucky Fried Chicken, bucket of chicken.
Finger licking good.
You guys enjoying a chicken?
Oh, yeah, it's delicious. I can't talk with my mouth full.
And let's try not to get the studio too greasy, Ginger.
I know it's a bad habit.
We're all going to be greasy after this show, and the microphones, we're going to get our greasy mouths back from the microphones.
We should wrestle after.
Yeah, in fact, Mike Neighbor's gonna come in Monday morning and wonder why his studio's all got oil and grease all over the equipment. Yeah, he's gonna wonder what the heck was the Cadillac Bill Show doing Friday night. Hey, Dan, you know what I think people want to hear?
No, what do they want to hear, Bill? What do they want to hear, Bill?
I think they want to hear the sound of you eating chicken.
Me eating chicken? Well, let me just give it a sample there,
yeah,
Bill.
Yeah,
hold
try
on. Here we
that.
Go. Ready?
Okay, everyone
ready?
Be quiet.
Ready listening? Oh, I missed the chicken, Bill. Hold on. That's delicious chicken, Bill.
That's
I just love that.
That was
a wing just wingless.
That was the most revolting thing I've ever heard. I think people may want to hear Ginger eating chicken now. I think people much want to. Okay, everyone be quiet. Here's Ginger. Sound of Ginger. Ginger right now is, she's licking the chicken breast. Wow. She's got the whole chicken breast in her mouth, ladies and gentlemen.
Working on the skin first.
Absolutely. So that's the sound of chicken or Ginger licking a chicken breast.
So, slow and steady.
Okay, so everyone, try not to make the studio too greasy. Now, I want to say, this is really cool. Like, 2 weeks ago when we were on the air, we had Lexi on, but after after the show, she told me this most amazing story. Her dad is a developer and a real estate developer, and with the dome, the stadium, the Hamilton Stadium. You know the Hamilton Stadium, Dan?
Tim Horton Field, Bill, where the Tabbies play.
The Tabbies, yeah. Her dad was the one who was trying to get the dome stadium set up to be a Barton and Bay. And her dad had a meeting. He sent the proposal over to Donald Trump.
Wow.
And Donald Trump liked the idea. And Donald Trump, they were going to build, like, it was going to be like a Pan Am Games. It was going to be the Tiger Cat Stadium.
It was going to be awesome.
There was going to be a hotel.
It was a perfect
bunch
location.
Of restaurants. It was going to be this big...
It would have blown away the Toronto waterfront, I believe.
Dan, it was going to be a Trump Plaza.
See?
We were going to have...
Just like Joyzy.
Trump right there. And this was about, 4 years ago?
At least that. At least that, yeah.
Yeah, so we're going to have one... Hey, was that a bell? I think I just heard a bell. So that means it is time for our bit that we tried a couple of weeks ago that went horribly wrong. It's where's they at or what's they doing...
What's they doing now?
Yeah. So this is where we call somebody and we find out what's they doing now. So Kyle, give this person a call. And I remember last time we did this bit, it went really badly. But I think this is going to be the worst bit in the history of radio. That's why we're going to keep doing this.
That's why we're here, Bill.
That's why we're going to keep doing. So now we're not. Right now we're calling Stacy Case. He first of all, he is a he. You guys want to hear what Stacy Case is up to?
Absolutely. Entertain us.
Okay, Stacy, are you there?
I'm here, Bill.
Hey, Stacy. Hold on a minute, Stacy. Just a sec, Stacy.
No problem.
Stacy.
Yes.
Hey, what are you doing right now?
Right now, I'm sitting in my backyard with a battery-powered turntable, listening to a 45 by Otis Redding called Direct Me.
Wow. Wow.
And I'm looking after my three cats who are having some backyard time.
And what are the names of your cats?
The oldest is Raisin. He's about five. And then there's Weasel. He's like two. And then the troublemaker, George, is one.
So this is Stacy Case with Raisin, George, Weasel, and...
George. Whoa, God. Hey. Sorry, my Raisin was just attacking George.
Raisin.
Yeah.
Did you hear that, Ginger?
Raisin.
Did you hear what Raisin's doing?
He's being a bully.
Yeah, good.
He's more being a father figure because he is the oldest. Like, now they've distanced themselves. George is on the step and Raisin's on the rock. They're not looking at each other.
Hey, Stacy, I hear monkeys. Can you hear the monkeys?
There are monkeys.
Listen to that, eh? Stacy, we've got to go. I just want to thank you for making...
No problem, Bill.
For making this probably the worst bed in the history of radio. What's they doing now?
And, you're welcome.
Thanks, Stacy.
Yep.
Yeah. So that was Stacy Case. Stacy Case. Hey, you guys been watching the news lately? Well, Ginger, I know you do. You're a news girl.
I always watch the news, Bill.
Ginger, you know what's going on in Puerto Rico? You're an expert on this, eh?
You need a cricket sound effect.
Apparently nothing much, I'm told.
Correct. Now, Ginger, I got to fill in on News Girl. There was a big hurricane. Hit Puerto Rico. You know all about this.
Tell me more.
Yeah. So a big hurricane hit Puerto Rico. And Puerto Rico, the American government, has not yet really been able to help out the people very well. The American government, Trump government, has a lot on their plate. They're dealing with Texas and Louisiana and Florida. So I was thinking, I think some country out there should offer to buy Puerto Rico. Now, I think they could get Puerto Rico for a really good deal. Part of the deal is you buy Puerto Rico, but you got to pay. You got to rebuild Puerto Rico, and I think if a country went to Donald Trump right now and said, "Hey, you know, we'll take Puerto Rico off your hands for just a mere $50 million," I think he'll say yes. Take it, get rid of it. Take it.
Call Lexi and see if her dad can call a meeting.
Yeah, Lexi's dad can make this happen. If there's any foreign diplomats listening to the show, which I highly doubt it, or any ambassadors to any countries listening to the Cadillac Bell Show, if they're listening, go to your president or your dictator and say, hey, I think we could get Puerto Rico for a bargain. Which country, Dan, you're a worldly man, which country is rich enough, which country do you think would be up for buying Puerto Rico?
Richard Branson. He's their neighbor.
He could buy
Puerto Rico. He lives right next door.
Richard, you see, Haiti. Haiti can't afford Puerto Rico. First of all, you've got to pay the $50 million to buy Puerto Rico. That's bad enough. But you have to rebuild it. That's going to be billions. Billions, Ginger, with a B. Ginger,
I don't even know what that is.
Ginger, you're a news girl. You know all about what's going on in the world. What country out there do you think could afford to buy Puerto Rico right now?
Oh, Bill. The Cadillac Bill Show.
Do you know Puerto Rico before the hurricane?
North Korea.
Okay, North Korea could not afford, they can barely afford to buy coal from China.
There's the answer, Bill. You just said it. China.
China might be able to afford it.
Yes. Sure. They build their own islands.
China could afford it.
Yellow Sea or someplace out there.
Ginger, give us another country who you think might be suitable for buying Puerto Rico.
I don't know. Australia, maybe.
I should ask you, Ginger, name another country.
Name a country.
Name any country. Ginger's not very worldly. She knows all about Hamilton and Canada.
Canada, there you go. There's a country.
Canada could buy Puerto Rico. Can we afford to rebuild Puerto Rico?
No.
No, probably not. But anyway, that's just some crazy idea. I just think at this point, the American government will say yes to any offer they get to buy for Puerto Rico. Get it off their hands. Ladies and gentlemen, we have the drummer from Teenage Head, Jack Pedler.
Yeah, hello. How are you now?
And of course, this is the UFO alien episode. That's why we've got you in. And also, Jack, this is his first public appearance in a while because you've been sick. You've been a bit sick last year.
Yeah, I tell you, the aliens have got me real good.
Well, the aliens are getting back at you for spilling the beans about what's going on.
I know. Yeah, mothership buried beneath Market Square in 1940.
What Market Square?
Hamilton Market Square. It's Lloyd D. Jackson now, but
we are really going
to... Yeah, the mothership is buried beneath Lloyd D. Jackson Square.
And
you can just tell by that by walking around.
You can tell?
Oh, yeah.
I can't tell. That's the last thing I noticed when I was walking by it, that, you know, I bet there's a mothership under here.
Yeah.
So, okay. Jack, folks, is a real knowledgeable about aliens and UFOs. First of all, give us a bit of a lowdown of all the different types of aliens that there are.
Well, I'm not going to go off and list them all, but there's about 7 or 8 of them.
Mm-hmm.
And the ones that are in control right now are not very nice, and they've been in control for quite a while.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
And what are they called?
Well, I would call them a... bad guys.
They don't have another name? I'm sure they don't go by that name.
Well, it could be commonly known as the Anunnaki.
Okay, all right. That's what we want. Our listeners are smart. They know about this stuff. They want to have actual names. So the Anunnaki, yeah?
I believe so.
And where are they from originally?
Planet X.
Okay. And when did they come
Nibiru.
Here? The galaxy.
A million years ago, yeah.
The galaxy of Nibiru. Is that right?
No, planet Nibiru.
Okay.
That's Planet X.
Okay. And who are the other aliens that have been living on this planet?
I don't want to start mentioning names because, you know...
Jack, you've already been sick. They're not going to make me sicker.
I can't let these names out of the hat.
Okay, folks. This is top secret stuff.
But I know there's some good people.
There's some good aliens out
good,
there.
Yeah, they're watching over, see?
So if we talk about the good aliens...
They're in the triangle ships.
Okay. So, now, okay, let's talk about the UFOs now. Now, the UFOs, I've noticed, they're different shapes. Like, they used to be like discs. Now they seem to be triangular.
And bells in the beginning.
Correct, yeah. Folks, they were like bells in the 40s. 50s and 60s, they were like flying saucers. Hey, Jack, I would like to, at this time, play some audio that I think you should hear. This is absolutely amazing. This is a Martian. His name is Alan the Alien. And this is Alan the Alien talking about creation and evolution and about how the Martians actually created us. If you've got this is a few minutes, folks, and I want you to listen carefully because this is fascinating. Absolutely staggering information. This is an actual Alan the Alien talking about creation.
I have haven't been back to Mars. It was millions of years ago since our descendants lived there. We've basically been right here the whole time, as far back as the dinosaurs. Longer, really. We started surveying and settling on Earth when the sun was much hotter and there was not much life here at that time. So we began to move many of the Martian life forms to this planet and settle them quite comfortably. Here, some of the animals didn't survive except in your folklore. We did create you in our likeness, and then we let you loose to go forth and multiply. It was really more of a combination of evolution and creation. The last 40,000 or so years have been dotted with myths and folklore that have helped to shape your development. Much of it was real. It was us behind a lot of it. We were gradually guiding you by sending down soothsayers, druids, angels, the gods of Olympus, and a slew of messiahs that we sent down to help out. We want you to know the truth, and it's best that we gradually let you in on it as many ways as we can. The Cadillac Bill Show is as good as any. We are not extraterrestrial. We've been right here for much longer than you have. Soon all the pieces in the puzzle will show the big picture clearly. With the help of all kinds of your artists and writers and the creeping bent, the picture is going to become clearer. Now go forth and spread the word.
Wow, that was something. That was an alien, ladies and gentlemen. And that was Alan, the alien, talking about he's a Martian. And basically, as a bit of a summary, was that life was happened on Mars. And then when Mars became uninhabitable, they moved all the life forms to this planet. And it's kind of like the Bible's Noah's Ark actually is about the spacecraft bringing the life forms to this planet, because Mars became flooded and then froze. And Noah's Ark is all about the aliens, the Martians, coming to this planet. Hey, Jack, what did you think of what Alan had to say?
He sounded like Jerry Lewis on Way Out.
He's a Martian. They don't all sound like dignified. They got funny voices. So now, how long have the aliens actually been on this planet? Have they been longer? They've been longer than humans, right?
About a million years.
A million years, eh?
Yeah. Martians came down about 65,000 years ago.
Yeah, Alan didn't mention exact time, but okay.
About 65,000. And they tried to take over the planet, and that was during Atlantis.
Oh, okay. All right. Jack, this is Victor. Victor, this is Jack.
Hey, how you doing there?
Great.
Right on, bud.
So, Victor, you were telling me about some UFO device.
Yeah,
tell us,
I used to build them. I actually built them when I was in high school. So a UFO detector is basically a compass. So I got one here. I'm just going to show the staff here. When you bring a magnet to the compass, it goes crazy.
Yeah.
When a UFO flies, comes near any home, and there's lots of newspaper articles quoting lights go out, clocks stop, car engines stop. Something to do with their anti-gravity equipment affects electromagnetic fields on the Earth. So just as you put a magnet near compass, makes it spin, it's very easy to change it into a circuit when the UFO gets close.
When the UFO gets close to this furry ring.
A wire on one, on the needle, and one on the outside circle. As soon as the electromagnetic field is affected, it will hit, and you will complete a circuit. When that happens, you can have lights on it, you can have a siren on it. I usually make the gizmos with LED lights and a doorbell. And they work quite effectively.
Hey, who's on the line?
Hi, Bill.
Oh, is that you, Janet?
Correct.
Hey, Janet, we're actually doing a show on UFOs, so I'm not sure if... Do you have anything you'd like to add?
Yes, I'd like to share this with the audience. This happened 2 years ago tomorrow. My husband and I were over on Sherman Avenue. It was in mid-morning. We were on our way back home. Something caught our eyes. We thought it was the sun. Instead, we looked up only to find this object was hovering right over us. Right over the streets, and it came with no sounds whatsoever. It was about the height of the tree lines, level with the rooftops.
Uh-huh.
We started screaming. It had the shape of an oval shape. We both started yelling, "What's that?" pointing to the sky. It was stationary.
Yeah.
It had orange and green ribbons zooming across, going around, 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 around. This was the sights that we saw. We could look through them as though they were clear clouds.
Uh-huh.
We saw people that would think they were your own family.
Family members, yeah.
One that looked like my own mother in her favorite green dress. Another one was an older woman seated, but their eyes were completely blank. They had a blank look.
And were these the people that were operating the spacecraft?
Correct.
And then one of them looked like your mother?
Wow.
One was my mother, because she was in her favorite green dress. The last time I saw her at a local family function. The other one looked like a much older woman that could have been my grandma.
Okay, so now how long was this UFO there at Sherman Avenue?
Under five minutes, I started hollering at this object, go to the airport.
You were yelling at it to tell it to go to the airport.
I hollered, get to the airport that way.
Get to the
airport. Pointing.
And what did it go to the airport?
You cannot have us. I had this funny in my, we are not your servants. And the last thing I said, but this was about within five minutes, I said, you are evil.
Evil.
You're evil.
Janet, I want to thank you for that story. That was really remarkable. Janet, thank you.
Oh, that was great. That was great.
And I never got that. It's in my date book.
And I mostly want to thank you for standing up for humankind all over the planet by telling them that we are not their servants.
Because it was very weird.
Thank you.
Good night, thank you.
Yes.
Cheerio.
Jack, what did you think of that? Was that a
beautiful story? That was
beautiful.
That's, you know, and she saw that. I know she saw that.
Yeah, no, she doesn't make stuff up. She really doesn't. Victor. Victor, have you ever seen a UFO?
I seen one in 1967. It was a cigar-shaped object.
Cigar-shaped, yeah, because in the 60s...
Monstrous device, and it was very loud.
There were
colored lights all around it. I woke up my younger brother at the time, got him out of bed to watch it.
Wow.
And he remembers it. I just want to mention a couple little things. The proper term for these aliens by the Canadian government is called EBs, extraterrestrial biologicals. That is the term that is used by most government agencies around the world. Now also, every major government on the planet has had face-to-face negotiations with the aliens.
That's all true.
Yeah, you concur that, do you, Jack?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. So Jack...
And supposedly what they say is that now they have the technology to get E.T. back home.
Wow. Well, aliens, this kind of is their home, isn't it? Earth is kind of is their home, is it, or what?
The moon.
They live on the moon?
Well, yeah.
Is that right?
The other side.
Now, what about under the water?
And planet Earth, they landed on the moon in 1949.
Who did?
The secret space program.
Humans?
Yeah, they were on the moon in 49.
So humans were on the moon.
And then Mars, yeah, in 1949. And supposedly they put up the flag of Germany.
I didn't think Germany was in any position to be going around space exploration after the Second World War.
Well, I don't know. It's just they put up the flag of Germany. Whoever it was.
Whoever it was.
And they landed on Mars in the early 60s, and by the late 60s had a up-and-running science community on Mars. And you'll see people talking about where they met Barry Obama on Mars.
They're going to bury Obama?
No, Barry.
Barry.
Yeah, well, that's Brock, right? That's his real name.
Yeah.
Barry.
So this is truly one of the most wonderful shows right now. And I do want to say something at this point. The Hamilton Public Library is where I work. And they this Tuesday, they are showing all the episodes of Downton Alley. Now, you may not remember those, but I did a spoof of Downton Abbey using stuffed taxidermied rats. And Ginger was Lady Harry, who was supposed to be actually Lady Mary. And Laurie Yates was one of the voices, and Sammy Squid. Dan Koltoff played Mr. Carson. Give him the...
That was the butler that always dropped his hat, and I hear that you've now immortalized Mr. Carson.
Correct, folks. The actor was a guinea pig who Dan did the voice for, and that guinea pig's name was Millie, who the little guinea pig who sadly died 2 weeks ago.
I liked Millie a lot, and Millie played the drums where she was eating a carrot, and that was the only vegetables that she liked, carrots. He tried every single vegetable except for carrots, and then one day she tried it, and she liked it. Millie looked like she had fancy pants. She was black and had a little bit of white on her, and she had a stripe like a belt. She can make Millie sound like squeaks when she's happy.
All right, so that was a little memorial for Millie by Amber.
Oh, Amber was great.
Rather touching that. And we are going to now wind down. We are done for this week. And we'll be back next week. And next week we're going to have a mime troupe on the radio to do a mime performance. So that's going to be absolutely fun. So I want to thank everyone, Jack and Vic and Dan and Ginger.
Yeah.
Cadillac Bill. We'll be back next week. Good 7 night. O'clock.
The Cadillac Bill Show. That's about it.
Good show, guys. Yeah.
Clean up your mess again.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, basically. Yeah,
Yeah, I kind of wondered why Hillary likes to get up at 5 in the morning so she can be the first lady. Here you go.